whose primary purpose and initiative on the college campus is to create student ambassadors for relief to those causes and issues in life that need help, not just locally and regionally, but globally. So I sit here advocating for those of you on a college campus. There is power in numbers, and there is knowledge that changes how we do and advocate or act and engage. So you have to ask yourself, what is it you don't know? Because it's what we don't know that doesn't motivate us. But once you know something, it motivates you in some way. And so predict that there are organizations for college students to be mobilizing, to be strategizing, to be organizing. And if you're not doing that on your in your college experience, if all you're doing is getting through the course and the degree and getting the academic paper in the end, I have a friend who tells me that her diploma in life is her baptismal certificate, not her academic degrees. I sit here today saying to you, advocacy for the kind of climate change issues we're dealing with is climate change for the soul. Organize, strategize, and mobilize.
Rick?
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to watch my time because honestly, when I start talking, anything can happen. So keep
all
going. Honest.
All we have for you is the book.
I don't want to be here. I don't enjoy talking about climate change. I don't enjoy hearing about it. But I have a moral obligation to do so. I'd rather, in my life, I think I'd rather be writing poetry in the country, by the water, having a very different life than I have right now. But I was born into a particular world and a particular time, as was everybody in this room. And we have a choice to make on how we respond to the information that we receive about the world in which we live. I've been put into a situation where I have to do things I don't like. I'm a full-time activist. It's hard. The hours are long. You're never done. It sucks. But there are good things about it, too. One is you can answer the voice. We were talking earlier. We were talking up here right now that you can answer the voice. And so that's what I've tried to do in my life. And as an activist, you also engage with other people. You step out of your comfort zone constantly. Sacrifice and risk, that's the name of the game. And so, if you haven't made sacrifice this week, if you haven't taken the risk, and you're aware of the challenges and the threats that not only exist for our grandchildren, right? It's driving me crazy out there. It's this book that came out, The Weather of My Grandchildren, right? And I talked with someone here today, yesterday, they're talking about something about their grandchildren. And I was like, this is right now. You know, and this has been me. I've been writing as a journalist, writing, you know, like 15, 17 years ago, started writing about climate change. And I kept hearing that title, The Weather of Our Grandchildren. And then I realized the person I was talking to already had grandchildren who were going into grade school or going into high school. I said, oh, now it makes sense because we're talking about right now. And so when I organize, I'm doing it in that way. There are people on the west side of San Antonio who live in highly developed concrete batch, you know, yards, plants, sprawling parking lots, that when a heat wave comes to San Antonio and it's 110 degrees for days in a row, it may be 101, 102 in the hill country or on the north side of San Antonio. There are components to this when you think about environmental justice, right? There are people who we heard earlier who are the least culpable or among the least culpable for the climate crisis who are on the front lines of the dangers and the destruction punishment that comes through the decisions empires, you know, collapsing empires. But this 500 years in the New World was genocide. And what followed that was a massive transfer of wealth from the global south, we call it, to the global north. And that exists on a global scale, on a hemispheric scale, as well as within our own communities. So I kind of came aware to this stuff as a journalist. You know, I grew up in a certain kind of political mindset, whatever. My parents were fairly political and a very kind of mainstream but engaged citizenship status. But I was aware of politics and the impact people could have in their world. I didn't have a degree in journalism. I got an English degree. I was going to be that writer and that poet and sit out in the woods and whatever. But I took a job and I went to work in West Texas for a very small newspaper and immediately ran into environmental racism, which, if you're not familiar with the term, it's going to be very clear. Odessa, Texas, if anybody know where Odessa, Texas is? Okay, couple, all right. Working town, right? 20 miles away from Midland, Texas, where the bosses live, the workers are over here in Odessa, right? There's a highway that runs through Odessa. On the south side of the highway is where the red line used to be. Who knows what a red line is? From a civil rights perspective, right? Okay. If you were brown or black in Odessa, Texas until not that many years ago, and you crossed that red line at night, you're asking for trouble. You're asking for violence, right? So what's south of that red line still? It had been the largest inland refinery complex in the United States until it began, you know, probably is again now because of the fracking boom. But these people were forced into these places. They didn't, you know, choose to live next to, you know, the most toxic spot in West Texas. They were roped into it, right? And in the same way, I've reported that story in Mississippi, in Houston, and wherever I've gone, it is the same people. It's not always people of color. It typically is. It can be very poor and uneducated white folk that are forced to live in land that has nominal value. But I've also come to look at land in different ways. We assume in it's like fish in water. You assume things like everything has a price, right? Because that's the world. That's the market. That's the way things work. I have come to believe that nature has rights, in the same way that my fellow human beings have rights, and that not all land is transactional, right? And so when you enter that space, you begin to see things like, okay, nearly 300 people living in a mobile home park in South San Antonio. Well, on the one hand, yeah, they were mobile home users, and they didn't own the land, and so the city had a right to throw them out for high-rise development. But on the other hand, these are people who had lived by the San Antonio River, and for in some cases, for 3 decades. What was their right? What was their relationship to the land? It becomes complicated, right? Issues like the border, you know. Yeah, there's a geopolitical boundary there, but there's a moral obligation to ignore that boundary when people are suffering. And the people fleeing Honduras, there is gang violence, but that last wave of unaccompanied minors, they were also experiencing the worst drought in 50 years, with people migrating out of the country and into the cities, the same as happened in Syria when Syria collapsed. So when we hear about Syria, would say that the moment we talk about our, what our response should be, I'd say number one, it has to be self-transformation. The compassion we feel when we talk about the future for our grandchildren, that's beautiful. But if the circle of your compassion only extends to the grandchildren that you can see yourself in because your compassion is this big, think about that. The compassion that we harbor, it has to include the guy in the back of the room, the neighbor who blasts, you know, the kahunto music all night long, people I don't like, I wish they'd just disappear. That kind of compassion, if you can't muster that, then how are you going to respond to a challenge like this? You have to be changed, and you have to choose to change. And San Antonio, the fractures we have here, I am here to speak like Eloisa, my partner over here with the city, working on a climate action plan for San Antonio, the first one ever. We've been busting our ass here. I've been writing about global warming in San Antonio since 2007, when it was
more traditional and they fit the, you know, hey, we have a meeting, come to our meeting. But there's also a lot of other ways that are not traditional. Canvassing, also just having general conversations with people that never have ever come to talk to us. Us coming to them, finding people within their communities, within the activities that they hold dear, whether it's their school events, right? We're talking about people that work possibly more than 40 hours a week. So we can't expect them to come
ask every person to fulfill the fullness of their religious tradition and their responsibility to the Creator. Yes, without any compromise, but to respect the responsibility of every other person to do the same. And then we avoid all negativity. We look for the good in each person, and we stick to our issues of the environment. And with this protocol, we have a sense of endearment with each other, with this sense of how good you are. And so it sets up the religious art form of drawing the best and the highest out of each other. And the fact that we get along so well shows that the protocol works. As we've addressed climate change, we've developed a book, Religion and Global Climate Change, a handbook for religious leaders and for activists. You can get it on Amazon. But we help religious organizations to see their responsibilities so that now we can say that across the spectrum of organized religion, with maybe two or three exceptions, religion's now a united voice on the importance of engaging climate change. One of the projects, and I'm going to focus on this, that we're emphasizing is not just reduce your carbon debt, but zero it out. And the way that you can do that is by planting trees. The average American contributes about 18 tons per year of CO2 into the atmosphere just by ordinary traveling around and lifestyle and food. But you know that every tree that you plant over 30 years will sequester about a ton and a half of CO2. That means that if you plant a dozen trees, 12 times 1.5, that each one will sequester, zeroes out your carbon debt. So we've gone down to Guatemala, and we work with the native Mayan Indians. yeah, but the way you're going to change it is one step, one thing at a time. So, your diet, eat lower on the food chain, and as much as it's in your power, cut out the beef. And then the second thing, make a commitment to be part of the solution, and over time, when you can, as soon as you can, leave fossil fuels and embrace solar and wind. There's more potential there than we can count. And the difference is, there's more millionaires in Texas, you know that, from wind power now than from oil. There are mega millionaires from oil, but the wind you don't own, as opposed to thinking that you can own what's down in the ground. Make an effort to switch when you can, as soon as you can. So just these four things, eating lower on the food chain, making an effort to get off of fossil fuels and set an example of alternative, clean, renewable energies, back off of consumerism. We don't need all this stuff. The happiest people you could ever meet are these people who earn $1 and $2 a day in Guatemala. Am I going too long? Should I wind it up?
2 minutes.
All right, thank you. I got a 2 minute warning from the bench. Be content with what you have. That's in Scripture. Be content with what you have. More stuff is not going to make you more. And do your best to zero out your climate debt, and I have opportunities to plant trees, and it's just $5 for a tree, but you know that that's several days' wages for a person in Guatemala. And you're doing good by planting trees, because if we had never cut the great forests of the world, we could have stabilized our climate, but we've cut. In my state, in California, we've only got 3% of the old growth redwood that's left. They were the tallest trees, and they were tall because they had a unique hydraulic system. Everything is unique. There's a slogan that we have, everything that lives is holy. If the doors of perception were cleansed, everything could be seen as it is, which is infinite. And the person that can see the infinite in all things, what do you think they see? But the hint of God in the world.
Thank you, Fred. I think any of our advocates and organizers up here would be happy to meet with you afterwards to talk about how you can get involved in their organizations, or if you have specific questions and answers. We're pretty much run out of time for this conference. One question that came up yesterday that I wanted to respond to, this is bringing things full circle, we started with Sister Gibbler, was what book one could read, and especially for those of you that are students. I thought about it some since I've used different books over the years in my courses, and I would recommend the book by Chelis Lindetting. My name is Chelis, and I'm in recovery from Western civilization.
centers and do direct action. And if you're interested in engaging, we've got a student coalition building from around the city. We've been working with UTSA and SAC, and we've been talking to students here to draw student power into the city and start making, you know, taking hold of the city because it's yours, as well as the homeowners and the renters. So that's my pitch.
I will also be here right after this, and I have my business card. I'd love for you to contact me directly, and I can talk to you about many different ways to get involved. The other thing I also want to mention is that we have paid internships that are year-long, and we have two of them that are coming up in the Office of Sustainability, so it's going to be posted soon. So another reason to grab my business card, right, so to make sure that we are connected. We have a position open right now that is for a summer fellowship, specifically a climate equity fellow, meant to target most impacted communities, climate action and climate